My name is François Spies, and I am going to present you a subject about embedded and connected receiver system for nanosatellites in low Earth orbit. So the presentation will start with satellite signal reception, then a form of deployment on mesh on Earth for ground station, and then I follow with the hardware and the software of the ground receiver, and how we are going to manage the Doppler effect on the signals. And I will finish with the functions to decode the signal. So first of all, why do we have nanosatellites on space? Because there is scientific and academic applications. There is also image processing application. And recently, we have more and more application about Internet of Things for isolated objects on Earth, like containers, small chips, sensors in desert land, wild animals monitoring, etc. And some projects are growing currently. So in the year 2K to 2012, there is something like less than 20 nanosatellites per year which are launched. And in the near future, it will be something like 500 to 1,000 a year. So what is our objectives on this ground receiver? We want to build a low energy and low cost ground receiver for LEO satellites. We want to use, of course, fast functions, mainly integer functions, to decode the received signals. But we need to take into account the Doppler effect. And we are going to avoid using filter functions in order to save energy and time. So the altitude of this satellite is around 400 to 600 kilometers. It takes something like 80 minutes for each orbit, and the speed is about 7.5 kilometers per second. And the coverage on the ground is around 5,000 kilometers. So usually the passes of the satellites is over north on the south pole, like on the graph. And there is an application. This is a view of a JPredict application, which deliver some information about LEO satellites on their passes. And on red here, you can see the coverage of the satellite. So what is inside the satellites? So usually you have communication on amateur radio frequencies, such as VHF or UHF, but also S-band. The transmit power is usually around something like half watt. And the modulation is mainly BPSK or GMSK, but there is also FSK, ASK. So the speed is quite low, between 100 and 10 kilobytes per second. And the Doppler effect is something like roughly 10 kilohertz for 400 megahertz. And the receiving power depends on the position of the satellite compared to the ground station. So on zenithal altitude, it will be something like 500 kilometers and minus 110 dBm. And for the satellite in horizon altitude, which means something like 2,500 kilometers, it will be minus 120. So this is the ground segment if you want to have 3,500 kilometers, but it's an optimistic view because SatNode.js, you see, is a realistic deployment, and it's not as well covered as this picture because we have nothing. It's just a way to have a good coverage on Earth. So if you have something like 80 ground station well placed in the world, mainly using Eduroam Wi-Fi connection, because you know that internet access is something which can be difficult in many countries. But when you have a university using Eduroam Wi-Fi connection, you can use this internet access. So what about the hardware components? We use three types of hardware. One which is powerful, which is a classic computer with an operating system using SDR USRP B200. And we use a GNU Radio or JQRX. And here we use also a Raspberry Pi Zero with Unix, Linux operating system, and the USRP B200 or the Pluto SDR, like in the previous presentation. And finally, we also use a microcontroller without any USB port, and we use, in fact, an SDR IP, which means the SDR is on another device. And then, thanks to the Wi-Fi connection, the microcontroller can receive the baseband signal. So for the software, we use JPredict, as I said, for satellite passes and also for Doppler correction. There is an option to do that. JQRX for converting the signal in baseband, and also GNU Radio to use and develop basic function, and also to generate a set of signal in order to test our function. And finally, we use also the IDE Arduino to develop our microcode on the ESP, on the microcontroller, ESP 8266. So this is a step to decode the signal from LEO satellites. So first, we need to detect a carrier near from the frequency, something like 10 kilohertz of accuracy. Then we need to synchronize the local clock with the received signal, something like more or less 300 hertz, in order to lock the synchronization. And then we can detect a BPSK signal in the synchronized signal. And finally, we construct the data using serial function in serial. So this is the frequency variation due to Doppler effect. So first of all, when the satellite is near from the horizon, you are going to have a high Doppler effect, but with a low variation. And then when you are when the satellite is on the zenith, you are going to have a low Doppler effect. But you are going to have a high variation, something like 880 hertz per second. So in order to understand the Doppler effect, this is a small example without the Doppler effect. So you have a BPSK signal times a carrier, and then you send it, and your signal is centered on the frequency choose. Then you have the Doppler effect, same things as the previous scheme, and then you are going to observe Doppler effect of something like 10 kilohertz, for example. And on the receiver, you are going to receive the signal times the carrier, and then you are going to receive the baseband signal, which is shift from the zero frequency. So finally, you are going to have to receive on the baseband a signal which is composed of the signal and the Doppler shift. The Doppler shift will be like an envelope with a low frequency, and the BPSK signal, which will be the high frequency, something like that. Something like that. That these are the envelopes. So the first task, is to recover the carrier at something like 10 kilohertz. So you have two or three options. So first, you can use GPredict, which deliver a calculated Doppler shift based on known satellite passes and the speed. But this information must be very accurate in order to have the right frequency. Transmitted signals are not always known and included in the satellite characteristics, so you need to add it in GPredict if you don't have this information. And sometimes there is a lack of accuracy on the satellite passes. So you need to take this into account, because you are not going to correct the carrier properly. So it can be used to activate the carrier recovery on predictive window time. This is a good point. Like this, you can receive at the right time according to the window. So if you don't use GPredict, you can use an existing carrier recovery with low consumption, but FFT can be out of this scope. So we are going to think about carrier recovery with low consumption, but it's still a job to do. And if there is many ground stations, the information about the accuracy of the pass can be exchanged between the ground station in order to have always a known Doppler shift. So what is the problem with unsynchronized signals? So when you have a nearly perfect data signal, you are going to see something very nice like these curves. But on a realistic data signal based on BPSK, or for example, with an additional low frequency, you are going to receive something like that. And it's quite difficult to read the data on such curves. So our idea is doing a transformation without using a filter function. So we measure the maximum amplitude on the signals, on the variation of the maximum amplitude over time. And when we see that here is the maximum amplitude, on the next one, on the next envelope, is at t plus delta t, and so on, we can define the low frequency. And then with this information, we can correct the signal. And to correct the signal, we use our piece of software on GNU Radio, and we output the results, the baseband signal, and we have an external program which calculates the maximum amplitude as on the previous slide. And then when we calculate the low frequency correction, we can send it back to GNU Radio in order to take this information into account in order to have a correct baseband information. And this is our loop, which is a software loop. So when we have all this information correctly, we can decode the data, and then using GNU Radio or a dedicated piece of software, we can do the serial tasks in order to get the correct information. So what are our results? Our results is the synchronization and the received signal works on GNU Radio on our dedicated source code on computer or on Raspberry Pi. So tests has been conducted on simulated signals using constant Doppler shift up to 500 Hertz. But we need to go further with Doppler effect with variation. So the demodulation and decoding of received data works on well-formed signals, but is not working currently on minus 110 dBm. But we are working on it. On the demodulation of data received on the microcontroller works, on signal can be sent by internet in a waveform or other things. So what are the conclusions? The conclusion is we had great experiences because, in fact, we are working a computer scientist on the electronics. And it's really interesting because of this piece of software. SDR is something like halfway between electronic and computer science. So we are looking on developing function which comes from a numeric world, but we are trying to avoid filtering when it's possible, of course. So we need to improve the demodulator function to very low signals in order to have realistic signals. Then we have to develop also a numeric carrier detection function for low power microcontroller. And probably we can add something in the set of ground station already, which are already existing, which are SAT Node.js, as we see previously. Thank you for listening. To compute the data. The ESP is not for the high frequency part, of course. It's only for the functions after the reception. Yeah, here is SDR connected to a real PC, and then we receive the baseband signal on the SP. Here it's ESP in the center, but there is bad contrast.
What is the lifespan of a nanosatellite? Does it fall quickly, or how long does it live?
It's something like 1 month to a few years. Is it the right question? Yeah. Sometimes this type of nanosatellites are working for a very short time because there is a bug in the embedded code on the. It depends on the altitude, but yeah, if on such altitude, probably it will fall in the next years. But on nanosatellites, usually there is no guiding. There is they are flying on their own. There is no motors, and not any motors, not any gas.